All of you here on this May 22nd. I want to begin with a few announcements before we get started. Our flowers today are from Jim Ton. Jim, thank you for the flowers in memory of Dot. So thank you so much. Appreciate that. We were to have a concert, part of our concert series this afternoon, Louis Sarovi with his classical guitar. They did rehearsal Friday night and someone came down with COVID. So he will not be performing this afternoon. And so if you invited anybody and then they show up and there's no one here and then they get mad at you for not telling them, then just do what I always do. If someone says, you said blah, 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 then you just say this. I never told you that. It works every time. Make them think they're the crazy one, not you, okay? So works like clockwork. This Thursday, we have a memorial service for Oki Mackie. She was a member here a long time. And so that's going to be at 11 o'clock right here in the sanctuary. Dennis Bunce comes up and tells us a little bit about what's going to happen next Sunday.
For almost 100 years on Memorial Day, the red poppy has been an appropriate symbol of the remembrance for thousands upon thousands of men and women and their families who gave it all as a sacrifice for others. Next weekend, this Memorial Day, the nation will honor those who chose to answer the nation's call and never got to come home again. Next week, we'll be distributing and taking donations for poppies in the Northex, with all donations going to the Paralyzed Veterans of America. We hope you'll join us in this remembrance. After this morning's ceremony, one of the young ladies who lost her father came to me and explained how he had lost his life in the Second World War and almost broke my heart. So I hope you join us next weekend for that. Also, if you're a cookie cooker, there was a bunch more C's in that line. I can't pronounce them anymore. So we'd like you to help us by joining our cookie cooking committee for one day in June and July as we prepare cookies for the upcoming services. Thank you.
Thank you, Dennis. Is that the cookie cutters? Is that right? Is that what that is?
Something like that.
Okay. All right. Cookie committee. All right. Very good. All right. Thank you very much. It reminds me of a story I heard of a dad and his son were in church together, and the son looked up and saw all these names on the wall. He said, "Dad, what are these names for?" He said, "Oh, these are the men and women who all died during the service." And he said, "Is it first service or second service?" So I am glad to know that in 33 and a half years of ministry, no one has ever died during the service that I was presiding over. So let's keep that record going. So we had a men's night out, Aviators game, was it just last weekend? Two Fridays ago. The women were up in arms. They were marching around here, you know, just all upset about they couldn't go. So we heard your cries. And so ladies' night out, June 3rd, Aviators game, women's ministry. So if you want to go to Aviators game, then you can sign up in the Narthex. We'd love to have you there. Today we celebrate our graduates, and we have two graduates, which you'll be introduced to here a little bit later. I was looking at my high school annual. Joshua was perusing through it. I was like, hope no one wrote anything too bad in there. There's my high school annual, 1981. I graduated 41 years ago. It's kind of hard to believe. And so do you remember where you went to high school? Do you remember what year you graduated? All that? Okay, that's good. Good. So, it was kind of fun to look through this earlier today. And there's even a topless picture of me in here. So I'm going to keep this under lock and key. But all my graduations took place in the 80s. High school, 81. College, 85. And seminary, 88. So with that in mind, let me invite you to stand up, greet one another by saying, happy graduation.
Please join me in a prayer of confession. O loving Father, your eyes so often see me sin, yet you always hear me calling. You're always there to see me when I fall, yet you're always there to catch me. You see the storms that plague my soul, still the voice that calmed the raging sea, that voice is there for me. Lord, forgive me when I so often fail. Guide me when I lose my way. Remind me when I so often forget the love that died for me. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Today's assurance is inspired by John 14. Let your heart not be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in Jesus. In his Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, he would have told us. He went to prepare a place for us, and in going to prepare a place, he will come again and receive us unto himself, that where he is, we can be also.
Indeed, amen. Please be seated. Hey, I'd like to invite our children to come on up for our time together. We've got something special for you today. Come on up. While the kids are coming up, how many of you like coffee? All right. How many of you like fancy coffee drinks? All right. How many of you like to make fancy coffee drinks? All right. We are looking for some extra baristas for our coffee shop. And so if you'd be willing to do that, please talk to me after the service. We'd love to get you. Come on up, Maggie. Come on up. Hannah, come on up. Good job. All right. This is how I stay awake every day on Sundays. I drink from the coffee shop. So we have free coffee in the fellowship hall, but we have fancy drinks in our coffee shop. Iced coffee. Anybody like iced coffee? Yeah. Iced cappuccinos. Smoothies. Anybody like smoothies? They're all there. And so all the proceeds that we get from the coffee and smoothies goes towards all of our Christian ed, whether it's be adult ministry, youth ministry, kids ministry. And so come on out and help support that. And if you'd like to be a barista, mix drinks, you get to have free coffee every time you do it. Just let me know after service, all right? All right, so all my awesome friends, good morning. How are we doing? Are you excited for school to almost be over? Wednesday, right? Wednesday's a big day. Beep bop, beep bop, beep bop. Right. Well, I've got something cool to show you. I'm going to bring up two of my favorite people, besides all of you guys, of course. And we're going to have a little graduation ceremony for them, okay? So let's invite our two graduates up to come on up. Here they come here. There's one here and one here. All right. Let's give them a hand. Oh, stay here. Stay here. I forgot the microphone. Brandon's gone. Okay. Brandon's got her own. She don't need me. Okay. Well, so let's turn around. We're going to face these two, all right? So I'm going to have these two lovely ladies are going to introduce themselves to all of us. They're going to tell us their name and where they go to high school and their favorite type of dinosaur.
Okay.
Nope. It's a surprise.
My name is Braylon Foster. I graduated from Founders Classical Academy of Las Vegas, and my favorite dinosaur is a velociraptor.
Oh. Kelly, get your own. Okay.
Hi, my name is Taylor Foster. I graduated from Nevada State High School, and my favorite dinosaur is, I would say a velociraptor, too.
Nice. Velociraptor, good. All right. That's good. Velociraptor's that. Okay, so can you also tell us one of your, or at least what your future plans are at the moment? What happens after you've graduated? Since both of you graduated this weekend, what are the future plans that are coming your way?
My future plan is to attend UNLV and get a degree in kinesiology.
I plan to go to UNLV, and I'm going to major in comprehensive medical imaging.
Right? Yeah. I went to college, so that was good. Yeah, that's great. Yeah. So, and then how about a memory of, or not memory, but what's something about Mountain View Presbyterian Church that you love? What's something that you go, hey, I love coming here because?
I love how welcoming the church is. A memory that I remember is attending and helping with a breakfast, like a breakfast for everybody. And just everybody's like being there and saying, oh yeah, we want you. Like, just come.
Yeah.
You're fine here.
Yeah. Oh, so what's something that you, about Mountain View Presbyterian Church that you go, I love Mountain View Presbyterian Church because?
Okay. You guys are all welcoming. I feel like whoever like comes in, you guys are like just so welcoming, and then you accept anyone who comes in.
Mm-hmm. Good. All right, and how about, oh, good, yeah, good. Come here. Yeah. And how about last question for you? What's something about youth group that you have enjoyed coming through the ranks of with me? You know, bless you for making it through. But yeah.
One thing I remember is all the mission trips. The mission trips are so much fun. There's so much that happens within such a short period of time that it's really just a blessing to go on them.
I would say the mission trips too, meeting new people, and then also helping your community as well.
Awesome. All right. Good job. Well, Miss Bertha here is going to come here in a second, but I just want to tell the congregation, Kayla and Braylon are both just amazing people. And Braylon, you see her up here helping lead us in worship quite often, or she's back there with the awesome audio-video team, helping them with, and so those of you who are online or here, she's part of that team, and always helpful. Kayla, I can't even imagine or think about how many dinners or events you've helped with, helping decorate the church for Christmas and then undecorating the church for Christmas. Any kind of events, Kayla and Bailey, both of them are always here helping. So it's been my pleasure, it's such a blessing for me to have both of you as part of the youth group. And, you know, as I said before, you know, we're going to be here for you as you go off, and we're still hopefully be home for you, a home base where you can come and know that you are loved and cared for. And that we're so proud of you. I've got a verse from the Bible just to encourage you with it. And so this is from the book of Joshua. And God tells Joshua this. He says, this is my command. Be strong and courageous. Don't be afraid or discouraged. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. And God is with both of you. And he loves you both so very much. And you're amazing children of him. And so thankful and excited for both of you in your next journey as you continue on over at UNLV. So we're here for that. Ms. Bertha.
Good morning. There's a big sign outside of our church that says, congratulations to the graduates of 2022. I know everybody that passes it says that's for me, especially if you're a graduate, and it is for all of the graduates in our community. But we say especially it's for the two of you because you're ours, and we just love having you and seeing you make this important step in your life. I have a little token for you.
Thank you.
This time of year, it's pretty special to me because I always remember it. I graduated a long, long, long time ago. But one of the things I do remember is that the women in my church were the ones who helped me to go on to make that next step. They collected monies and helped me to get going in college so that I could continue. And that's what I thought I should do, is try to do that for my people who have passed on it into college as well. So when I graduated from high school, when I graduated from college and came into my first church where I had grown up as a little girl, I now send them something for their graduates. And for my most recent church in San Diego, I still send something, a token for them, because it was the church that got me started. And I think it would be the church that will keep you going on your journey, and we just congratulate you and wish you the very best.
Thank you.
So this is the second time they've done this today. So this time they get to keep their gifts that I'm giving them. And Kayla, for you, Braylon, for you. Yeah, you can open them this time. Yeah. Well, okay, so we're going to grab hands, everybody, up here. Come on up. We're going to grab hands. And we're going to pray for our graduates here. Maggie, come here. Here, hold my hand. Okay, can you hold Braylon's hand, too? Can you hold Braylon's hand? Okay, good job. Okay, that work? That's perfect. All right, we're going to pray. Dear Jesus, thank you for our graduates. And we pray for them. And we bless them. And we thank you for them. And we thank you that you go with them everywhere they go. And you love them. And you love us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. So proud of you too. Good job.
Let us pray. Holy Lord, mighty God of heaven, the God that answers prayers, where two or three are gathered together in your name, so you have promised your presence as well. We welcome your presence, O Lord, and we pray you manifest your purpose this day. We want you to shine your light in us, through us, that we may illuminate others for you. As we tarry in your presence today to worship, reveal unto us the knowledge of divine mysteries of your word that will transform our lives forever. In all humility, we come together as a church family. We come together to praise you and share your love with one another. Please give us a fresh strength and vitality today to walk in your way, thrive in your grace, and share the joy of your grace with others. O Lord, we pray for peace. And we pray your grace be made evident to all the innocent nations of the world. Again, we give thanks for all we received from you that we hold dear, our family, our friends, and our community of faith. We ask blessings for all who serve in every capacity the needs of the church, the community in our country, and a world needing your mercy and love. Finally, we pray together in a manner as our Lord and Savior taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you, Dennis. Well, good morning, church. Well, Friday we had quite a bit of fun. So Pastor David is part of Summerlin Rotary, and they hosted a golf tournament on Friday, and I was invited to play part of that foursome. Shane was there, and another pastor friend. I think we all agree that my contribution was absolutely essential to the team's effort. We all agree. That's good. We... Anyway, the benefit was for four groups that are making a difference in the lives of veterans. And the one that really was most moving to me out on one of the holes was a guy. He was a veteran and had been paralyzed and has invented this amazing machine that allows our vets to strap them in, and they can actually stand up. And he hit our drive on that hole, 275 yards, 300 yards, I don't know, amazing. And it's life-changing for these guys who don't have lost the use of their lower extremities. They can get up, they can be active, they can be engaged, and it's just, like I say, life-transforming. Between services, we put together more homeless care packs. So we've got more of those available for you. So grab those and have them available in your car to pass out to folks in need. You know, there are 50,000 homeless veterans in the United States. And you just don't know. Here in Las Vegas, how many of those who are homeless would have served us? So grab some of those homeless care packs, and when you hand that to somebody, it may just be somebody who served us, and in some small way, we can serve them and thank them in return. Amen.
Well, with that, if you are willing and able, would you stand with us as we continue to praise and sing this morning?
the breath in our bodies. You gave us life. You breathe your life in us every single moment of every day. We give you all the honor and all the praise of everything. It's in your precious name we pray all of these things. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you. Thank you, Redeemed Worship Praise Team. So our scripture lesson comes from Joshua, the book of Joshua. We're continuing our sermon series on discovering God. What's the story? Discovering God one story at a time. And so today we look at the fall of Jericho. And this is under Joshua's leadership, and we'll get into how Joshua got to where he was in a few minutes. But I'm going to read for us the story that we're reading, talking about today, is from Joshua chapter 6. And if you want to turn there in your Bibles, go right ahead. But we're going to look at Joshua 1, verse 8 or verse 9 for our scripture today. It's exactly what Chris read to the graduates today. And this is God speaking to Joshua. Let's listen now to God's word. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened, and do not be dismayed. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. And Joshua would need to hold on to those words for all the days of his life and what he's about to encounter. So may God add his blessing to the reading, the hearing, the understanding, the blessing, the application of this, his holy word. Let us pray. Gracious God, may we decrease and may you increase, and may the words of my mouth and meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, you are our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. So let's get a little context here of how do we get to this part where Joshua's leading a group of people they're in the Promised Land, and they take on the city of Jericho. So let's move back 40 some odd years. You've got Moses. We've talked about Moses during this sermon series. He's led the people out of Egypt. And now he's going to the idea is to lead them into the Promised Land. And so as they are traveling, they get up close to the Promised Land. They can see the Promised Land. It's just right there on the other side of the river, of the Jordan River. And this is going to be great, so let's get over there. But Moses says, well, before we do that, let's send some spies. How many spies is he going to send? 12. So we've talked about this before. Come on, help me out here. Yeah, anytime I ask a numerical question, the answer is either 3, 7, 12, or 40. Okay, so Moses, he's going to send out a number of spies. How many spies is he going to send out? 12. Good job. All right. So he sends out the 12 spies. This is them right here. One representing each tribe of the tribes of Israel. There's 12 tribes. One spy from each tribe. They go out into the land, and they go out there. They cross the river. They go in, and the land is unbelievable. I mean, it is the Promised Land. I mean, there are clusters of grapes with grapes as big as your fist to eat on. The land is flowing with milk and honey from the date trees and the date palms. I mean, this is the problem. They're so excited, and so they come back. And Moses gathers the 12 and says, okay, listen, okay, what's the report? What did you find? They spent how many days out in the Promised Land? 40. Good answer. Boy, you guys are awesome. So they spent 40 days in the Promised Land. They come back. Moses, okay, what? Tell me. 10 of the spies, these 10 right here, just in case you're wondering, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Took a long time to find that picture of these 10 cowardly spies. They say to Moses, Oh my gosh, we ran into giants over there. The people are so big. Wait, this guy's even wearing a San Francisco Giants shirt. Oh my. The giant, we look like grasshoppers compared to how big the men are over there. We can't take the land. That's what 10 of the spies say, because there's giants. But there were two very righteous, holy spies, these two right here. Go Dodgers! Who say in the very next line, we can take the land. We can. We can do it. Well, who ruled the day that day? The majority ruled. And the 10 spies, their idea, we can't, won the day. And so now begins this 38-year journey. Sometimes we call it about wandering through the desert. They didn't wander. The people of Israel, yeah, there's a million strong. They didn't wander through the desert. They went exactly where God told them to go. He led them by fire and by a cloud of smoke. And so they would go, they would just, okay, we're going over here for a few weeks. Oh, and now we're going over here. And now we're back over here. They just went in this huge, like, big circle for 38 years because God said, this is the land. It's yours for the taking. And you thought, we cannot take it because you got eyes on giants and not on me. And so therefore, everyone alive at this moment in time will just circle the desert until you all die off, and then a new generation of people will go into the promised land. And so a new generation goes into the promised land, but who gets to go also? Joshua and Caleb, because they were two people who said, we can take the land. We can take the land. So let me ask you a question. It'll be one of many questions I ask today. Who do you surround yourself with? I think it was Jim Rohn who said, we are the average of the five people we hang out with. We are the average of the five people we hang out with. So let me ask you this. Do you surround yourself with people who say, we can? Or do you surround yourself with people who say, we can't? We can't. And I'm not saying, oh, let's just follow blindly, you know, wherever. Oh, yeah, we can do that. Yeah. But just, you know what I'm talking about. There's people who are all, we can. We're here to support. We're here to love. We're here to push. We're here to pull. We're here to nudge. We're here to, let's move forward. And there's other people who just, oh, we can't do that. We can't do that. And I'll go so far as to say today, the mainline church of which we are a part of, Presbyterians, along with other mainline, this is one of the reasons we are so far behind so many other like non-denominational churches and things going on in the nation, is because we have been a people of we can't for so long. And I want to encourage all of us to be a people of we can. Just like when I first got here, well, before I got here, I think it was a year before I got here, 7 years ago, these screens got put up. Do you know how much arguing went over whether we should have screens in the church? A lot. Unbelievably so. It was like, I can't imagine worship without screens today. They help us worship. They help us with the words. They give us visual imagery of things we're talking about. I mean, they're wonderful. When I first got here, I've told you this before. When I got here before, someone approached me and said, you can't have a youth ministry here. Why? Well, the average age of this church is 78. And when we had Gertrude, who was 102, pass away, and we had a baby born on the same day, that was a great day to bring down the averages in our church. But no, we can't have a youth ministry. But we can't have young families. We can't. I'm really glad we have Chris Kirschman on our staff. Yes? Yeah. I'm really glad we have young people coming up front for a children's sermon. That young people know that they're welcome here. That this is a place of that they can be a part of it and hang out. I'm glad that my children have a youth group and someone to look up to and as a mentor and as a role model in Chris. When I first got here, we can't have adult mission trips. You're like 23 years old as a church. How come we've never had an adult mission trip? We can't. Why? I don't know. We just can't. Well, a few years ago, before COVID, we went to Alaska. And then this summer, we're going to Honduras. And hopefully, year after year after year, we will have adult mission trips. Another thing that happened when I got here, in April. April the 5th was my first Sunday. July 5th, 2 months later, we had our first contemporary worship service. You can't have contemporary worship in a church. Why not? Because, it'll never happen. You can't. And for months after we started the contemporary worship service, I would hear, when are we going back to two traditional worship services? We're not, we're moving forward. How many of you listen to classical music on the radio? Okay, 8 of you. Okay, all right. And one of you is under 60. Okay, very good. All right. So we want to be contemporary. Nothing wrong with classical music. Nothing wrong with traditional music. We want to offer the best of both worlds, the best of contemporary and the best of traditional music as well. We want to offer the best. Now, the biggest can't that takes place that I see, hopefully not as much as I used to, is you can't sit in my seat. Yes, We've all experienced that one. Yeah. This is why my seat's up front, because no one sits up front except for me and my family and the other two wise men. So now it's time for Joshua. Joshua has received the mantle of leadership. Moses is not going to make it into the promised land, at least on this trip. We know years later, when he appears with Jesus and Elijah in the Mount of Transfiguration, we know Moses made it to the promised land. But Moses, while they're circling the desert, they need what? They need water. They're in a desert. We're in a desert. We need water. And so God says, if you'll just say to this rock, water come out, water will come out. And so Moses, he's in front of a lot of people. You want to make sure you got your stuff. And so Moses approaches the rock, and as he says, water come out, he takes his staff and he hits it. Did God say, hit the rock? And he said, just say to the rock. But Moses was like, I'm not sure saying something is going to work. So he hits it. And God said, you can't make it to the promised land. Now, from a theological standpoint, what commentators have said throughout the years, is Moses, he was the giver of the what? The law. And from a theological standpoint, the law by itself cannot get you into the promised land. It can get you up to it, but it cannot get you into it. It takes faith in Jesus Christ to get you over. The law only just shows us, and Chris talked about this last week, shows us where we go wrong, but it never gives us the power to overcome that which we do wrong about. So now here it is. It's Joshua. And the Lord says, be strong and courageous. I'm with you. I'm going to be with you wherever you go. And now the promised land is for your taking. And so now here they sit on the banks of the Jordan River, and they just got to cross it. And so Joshua says, well, let's send in how many spies to go check it out one more time? Wow. Just two this time. two were right last time. Let's make sure it's just two this time. So he sends two spies. Well, I'm sorry. Forgive me. I'm ahead of myself. There's two spies into Jericho. But let's back up again. They're getting ready to go in the promised land. And so, cross the Jordan River, he gets the priests together. And this is what he says to the priests. If you will just put your toe in the water. I'll split the Jordan River, and you could walk across on dry ground. So priest, come on, come on, come on. Me? Yeah. You sure? Yeah. Dry land. And they take the Ark of the Covenant, they put it right there in the middle of the Jordan River on dry land, and the people walk across. I'm wondering how many people here today, there's something itching in your brain. There's something on your heart. There's something you think, it may be crazy, but you've been wanting to do. You've been wanting to try. You've been wanting to seek out. And I think today God is saying, if you'll just put your toe in the water, I'll clear the way for you. But I need you to put your toe in, just your toe. And I'll make dry ground appear, and I'll let you get across to where you need to go and to where you need to be. Don't hang back from the banks. Put your toe in the water and watch what God will do. He'll take care of the rest for you. But just put that toe in the water. So now they're approaching Jericho. It's the first city. It's the first opposition. It's the first people who are saying, you're not taking the land. You're not taking the promised land. And so now it's this fortified, walled-in city. And so now Joshua is going to send how many spies?
Two.
That's right. And the two spies, they go into the walled city. And how they got to where they got, I don't know. I'm not going to even conjecture how they got there. But they end up in a prostitute's house. Let's not make any judgments here. Two men alone in the desert. Never mind, you know. But here they make it, and her name is Rahab. And Rahab says, hey, come on in here. You need to know people in the city are looking for you. They know the Israelites are coming. They know we're in trouble, and they're looking for you. If I hide you at the risk of my own life, will you remember me when you take the city? Can you remember me? And the spies say, we can, and we will. And so then the two spies, they leave. There's a search party for them and everything, but they wait, they're hidden, they leave, and they come back to Joshua and say, we can take the city, but let's make sure we take care of Rahab and her whole family. Okay. So now, you got Joshua, you know, they got chariots, they got spears, they got battering rams, they got catapults, bows and arrows, they got it all. Okay, how are we gonna take the city? Well, hold on. Lord's got something to say about this. Okay, here's the plan. We're going to march around the city, and the priests are going to blow a horn. Okay, but when do we knock the walls down? No, that's it. They're going to... So let's listen. This is what the people of Jericho heard for 7 days straight. While the priests were going around the city, walking around, so listen to this. And Joshua says the priests are going to blow the horns. And we're going to march around the city, and on the seventh day, we're going to shout. And when we shout, the walls are going to come tumbling down. And the people are like, are you for real? So when I was in youth group, one of my favorite songs was, Joshua Fit the Battle of Jericho. Why it's fit, not fight or fought, I don't know, but Joshua Fit the Battle of Jericho. How many of you know that song? Okay, I'm going to sing it for us. And if you'd like to sing along, please don't. It'll just mess me up, okay? So, but there's a part in the song where it says, and Joshua commanded the children to shout. And when I say shout, all of you will shout out the name of your high school that you went to, okay? So for me, I'm going to say Orange High School, you know? So the song goes something like this. Joshua fit the battle of Jericho, 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 oh, Joshua fit the battle of Jericho, and the walls came a-tumbling. Down to be down, to be down, to wah. Down to be down, to be down, to wah. You may talk about your man of Gideon. You can talk about your man of Saul. But there's none like good old Joshua at the Battle of Jericho. That morning, Joshua fit the Battle of Jericho. Jericho, Jericho, oh, Joshua fit the Battle of Jericho. And the walls came a-tumbling. Down to be down, to be down, to why? Down to be down, to be down, to why? Right up to the walls of Jericho, he marched with spear in hand. Old Joshua commanded the children to shout, Orange High School! Orange High School. And the walls, I say the walls, came a-tumbling down to be down, to be down, to wah. Down to be down, to be down, to wah. Joshua. There you go. There we go. And the walls came tumbling down. Victory secured. City taken. Promised land became that which it was, the promised land. Are you facing any walls these days? Fortifications? Strongholds? That you just think, there's no way. We cannot. I cannot get through it. I cannot get over it. I cannot get around it. I don't know what to do. It might just be God giving you an opportunity to do something out of the ordinary. Do something that you never thought of. For Joshua and the Israelites, it was yelling at a wall and it came down. They gave it a shout and it came down. Maybe what you've been doing, maybe what I've been doing to kind of get around this or get through this, just not working. Maybe there's got to be a new strategy, something just totally bizarre. The guy would say, hey, maybe try this. Well, I don't think that's going to work. Maybe we can versus we can't. And let me just say one more thing about we can and we can't. We spent the last 2 years during a pandemic saying we can't. I think it's time now to start saying we can. You know, we can as a church. We can. Tired of hearing we can't. Well, the walls came tumbling down, dooby down, dooby down, doo-wah. And Rahab the harlot and her family were saved. Can you save us? We can. We can save you. And they did. Are you one of the types? I used to be one of the types. When you get to Matthew chapter 1, it starts talking about all the genealogy. Let's just skip to the good part. You know, when does Jesus get born? Let's flip pages. But do you ever stop and wonder who's in the family tree of Jesus? Do you know who's in the family tree of Jesus? One of them. Her name is Rahab. Rahab the harlot. Rahab the prostitute. Rahab the one who said, if you'll come over here, we'll hide you out for a couple days, but can you save me? We can, and we will. And so Rahab becomes the mother of Boaz. And Boaz gets married to Ruth, who we talked about a few weeks ago. And they have a child named Obed. And Obed grows up and they have a child named Jesse. And Jesse grows up and has a son named David, who becomes King David. And it goes on and on and on until who's born? Jesus is born. Who is who? The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. All because a couple spies said, we can. We can't take care of you. If you've ever felt like you cannot be used by God because of questionable character, a checkered past, a soiled reputation, the answer is you can. You can be used by God. You can be used by Mountain View Presbyterian Church. It's one of the reasons I'm here, because this church said, I think we can use you. Thank you. God used, you know, Rahab in an amazing way. And then we get to Jesus. And I don't know how much Jesus shouted during his ministry, but I do know when he was up on the cross, he shouted, "It is finished! It is finished!" And when he yells out, "It is finished," you know what happened next? The walls came a-tumbling down, the curtain in the temple, the curtain that separated the people from the Holy of Holies. Who could go in the Holy of Holies? The priest, the chief priest. How often? Once a year. He says, I can go in, but you cannot, because you're not holy. You're just ordinary people. And when Jesus shouted, "It is finished," the curtain was torn in two from the top down to the bottom. And Jesus, when he says, "It is finished," he's saying, you can now come into my presence. And I get to be in your presence. There's nothing separating us anymore. There's no priest you have to go through. There's no person you have to go through. There's no wall you have to go around. It's you and me. We can be together. We can be reconciled. We can be joined together. You don't have to go through your pastor with a prayer request. You got equal. I have access. You have access. We have equal access. When people say to me, "David, I know you got a bigger pipeline to God than I do." No. My pipeline, your pipeline is the same size. You know, just whatever size that is, it's the same. Equal access. Equal access. I find it fascinating that Jesus is the Greek word for the Hebrew name Joshua. He who saves. Those who thought they cannot have fellowship with God, they can. Those who believe that in their hearts that Jews and Gentiles cannot coexist, they can and they do. Those who, I'm just so mired in sin and addiction and I just cannot get out, you can. You can. You can overcome sin. We can overcome death. We can have eternal life. And with God, all things are possible. And then along in the storyline comes a guy named Paul. And Paul, he's a Jewish guy. He's a Pharisee. He's a leader. And you know what he says? We can't have Christians around. They're destroying the Jewish traditions. They're destroying who we know God to be. And so let's get rid of Christians. And I'll be glad to help, because I can get rid of Christians. And he does. In fact, he's the one standing there when Stephen, the first martyr, is stoned to death. There's Paul. I'll be glad to hold your jacket while you stone. Yeah, let me have your jacket. Yeah, oh, okay, I can hold that for you. Yeah. Right over here. Let's stone this guy, because we can't have Christians around. And then Paul is on his horse, his high horse, you know, going to Damascus. And God's like, I think it's time. You think it's time? I think it's time. Knock him right off his horse. Hey, what are you doing? Why are you doing this? Let me tell you what's going to happen, Paul. For the next 3 days, you're not going to eat, you're not going to drink, you're not going to be able to see. I'm going to blind you for the next 3 days. We're going to get you to Damascus. You're going to get to your final destination, but you're going to be blind. So they take him, and they put him, you know, in a room somewhere. And for 3 days, you can't see, you can't talk, you can't drink, eat, well, everything. You're just sitting there, not so high and mighty now. And then God calls this guy named Ananias. Hey, Ananias, I need to let you know, Paul's in town. Oh, wait a minute. You mean the guy that kills Christians? Yeah, that's him. I need you to go minister to him. What does Ananias say? I can't. He kills Christians. You know what you're asking of me? I do know what I'm asking of you. And then Ananias says, I can. And he goes over. And how does he address Paul? Brother Paul, I come to you in the name of God the Father. Puts his hands on him. The scales fall off. And then Paul begins his ministry. Writes 13 books in the New Testament. Travels all over the world, establishing churches, encouraging churches. And then he writes this to the church in Philippi in chapter 4, verse 13. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And you can too. Amen. Let us pray. And gracious God, thank you for today. Thank you for making walls come tumbling down, to be down, to be down, to wah. Help us to be a people who can, not a people who can't. And let's just put our toes in the water and see where we go. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So now let me invite you to take the friendship pad located on the center aisle there and write that. Write your names and numbers and pass that people sitting next to you. Also, lift up to God our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings. And I know we're running a few minutes late here, but that's all right. So you saw Bertha Pendleton up here with the graduates. And she always gives them a little money to help them get on their way. And because she grew up in Alabama back in the, how old is Bertha, 90-something years old? I don't know. That was a long time ago. African-American, Alabama. Went to the Handy Chapel. Is that right? Handy Chapel, A-M-E, Church. And she wanted to go to college, and she didn't have enough money to go to college. And so the women of the church said, let's put some money together. And so they got her to Knoxville College. It was a teacher's college. I don't know if at that time if it was all women's college or not, but it's Presbyterian College. And it's because of the gifts and the offerings of the people of Little Handy Chapel got Bertha to go to college. And then Bertha went on to get some graduate degrees. And then she ultimately ended up as a superintendent of schools in San Diego. All because a little church said, hey, here's some offerings. Here's something to help you out. Here's a gift. And so your gifts, they help. They help people all over the world do things, become things, and allows people to say, we can. We can do this in ways that maybe they never thought possible. So thank you ahead of time for your gifts and your offerings.
How great is our God, and all will see how great.
Amen, amen, amen. Hey, thanks for coming out. And let's remember, we can. So let's go forth in the world in peace and be of good courage. Let's hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Love and serve the Lord with gladness and with joy. Honor all people. And laugh often and fear not. And go forth knowing that the unconditional love of God the Father Almighty, the amazing grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the fellowship, communion, the power of the Holy Spirit is with you now and forever. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Go get them.